If you had one shot, one opportunity to seize everything you ever wanted, one moment that you captured, just let it slip. Yo,
his palms are sweaty. Good evening. You have reached Does It Make Sense? Hosted by Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas. Rocky and Karen are not here today. Today, you have Rick Ector, joined by my co-host, Jared Maynard. You are listening to us on 910 AM, the SuperStation. We are streaming live, so check us out online. Our URL is 910amsuperstation.com. We're looking to have a very energetic, a very lively conversation today. You know, an unfortunate incident happened this past weekend, and I'm sure you're anxious to come online and talk with us about some of those details. You know, the devil is always in the details. Let me throw the call-in number. It is 313-209-9000. Feel free to chime on in and let us know what your thoughts are. Jared, you want to lead us in with an overview, a recap of what happened this past weekend that's got everyone up in arms?
Well, you know, first got me up in arms is, you know, this co-hosting thing. Rocky always tells me I host, and then it's co-hosting.
Oh, so wait. So I at least acknowledge that you're the co-host, and you're not happy with that. You would rather be the host and me play sidekick. See, I was willing to share the spotlight and top billing with you, but, you know, I think you're getting a little too big for your britches, Jared. Let's share.
Rocky might agree with you, you know.
Since you punted, let me go ahead and set the stage.
I won't punt for you. We'll talk about what happened. You know, we'll set the stage. Everybody knows, if you've been watching the news, we had a crazy wacko shoot up a gay bar in Orlando. And that's what everybody's been talking about. And when you look at it, there's been discussion on what's right and what's wrong. Should people have had a gun? What should have happened with that individual? What made that individual do this? I think that's what everybody's talking about. It's just heartbreaking. It's disgusting that in this country, those people were murdered because that guy does not like Americans. And this is my opinion. Mm-hmm. That guy does not like Americans, and he didn't like the fact that two men were kissing. So that should be a wake-up call to everybody, that they don't like Americans, and they don't like the fact that we have a pluralist society where multiple people with multiple views can exist in a country. They just don't like it.
You know, I echo your sentiment. The thing that truly – well, first and foremost, let me say this, and I truly mean it. You know, my heart and prayers and thought goes out to the victims, those who – succumb to their injuries and those who are hopefully, you know, going to make a recovery, and to their families, you know. And it's heinous. It's atrocious. It's terrible. It's all those adjectives that describe unspeakable acts of horror and, of course, of terror. And as we're, you know, our nation's federal government is trying to do their investigation and figure out, you know, exactly what happened. I think there was some chatter that there might be an accomplice out there that they're looking for. They're trying to zero in, trying to find out who aided and abetted this guy, trying to determine, you know, the level and the extent to his ties to extremist, jihadist, Islamicist, radical sect of his religion, you know, trying to determine, you know, or was it, you know, he's just a homophobe, someone that just has a problem with homosexuals. And I really don't think that that's the issue. You know, if you're a homophobe and you don't like gay people, you know, it has to go to some other place on some other level for you to decide that the way that you're going to resolve this problem that you have with people's lifestyles, that you're going to go into a crowded establishment where you suspect that a huge number of them to be, and just slaughter them and kill them without a second thought or a second notice. It's totally despicable. But the thing that really bothers me, it's readily apparent to even the most casual observer that we were hit, we were attacked by a terrorist. And we're talking about...
Whoa, that's some dangerous talk there.
Dangerous language.
The left is not going to like that.
You know, we can't worry about what the left thinks. You know, there's safe places, right? This guy was a terrorist. He was a jihadist. He had some extremist ideology. And you know what? That's what we can say about these extremists, these jihadists. They hate us. All of us. They hate the gay people. And they hate the heterosexuals, too. They hate all of us. They hate our lifestyle. They hate our freedoms. And they try to attack us by instilling fear in us. And despite all of that, you know, instead of us coming together as a nation to determine how we're going to fight terrorism, you know, it's almost like a reflexive reaction amongst the left wing of this country. Already, I'm hearing the clarion calls for more gun control. I'm hearing people complaining that it was the gun. I'm hearing people complaining that it was the type of gun. Maybe it should have been some old single-shot muzzle-loading long gun Kentucky rifle that was used in the Revolutionary War or the Civil War, because then it takes him maybe 5 minutes to load the doggone thing. But you know what? If he shot and killed that many people, regardless of how many magazines he had, he was in there reloading. And you know what? Those people were in there. They were like sitting ducks up against the wall or scurrying wherever they could hide. And you know what? He had all the time in the world to commit this atrocity. And it just leads into several of my key issues as it relates to extremists, jihadists, terrorists, or otherwise criminal behavior.
You know, I think before we go down the gun path, because they're already trying to do that with the left, I'm just going to echo what you said. There are parents, 50 of them at least, that have lost a child. There are brothers and sisters who've lost a brother or sister. There's people who have been... I don't think we'll even know the impact this will have for a long time. And I just, you know, in some of the things you see on the DetroitNews.com is you see people, you know, Detroit loves Orlando, we're praying for you and everything like that. Those are things we should be doing now. We should be coming together. But instead, we need to have a conversation about guns. And one of the things that I saw on Facebook was very interesting. One person had a gun in that room, and 103 people were effective. What would have happened if somebody else turned the tables on him? And number two, when are we going to have a serious discussion about how they view us? They do not like our freedom.
Ooh,
everybody's
you're treading on dangerous
freedom.
Talk now, Jared.
Well, you know, it's,
where's my safe space?
Well, your safe space is out in the green room, and we'll talk to Rocky about why you need a safe space. But
I need a safe space, man. You're encroaching on hate language here
because
you're daring to insinuate that these Islamicist, fundamental, radical extremists who pledge their allegiance to ISIS and that black and white flag, you know. You're playing into their level. You're being a bad man. You know,
I'm not a bad man. I just love America, and I believe we all have a freedom. It's guaranteed to us by God. It's written in our Constitution. We declared independence from oppression before, and what they're trying to do is go around and oppress the world, oppress them all into their particular viewpoint. And in America, whether you like it or not, there's multiple viewpoints. Whether you support it or not, there's multiple viewpoints.
Yeah.
And as an American, I may not like your opinion. I may tell you I don't like your opinion. Mm-hmm. But I will always stand up for your right to say your opinion, and you should do the same for me. Because that's
agree.
What this country's here for.
I agree wholeheartedly. And, you know, I've been hearing a lot of illogical arguments today made in support of the contrary opinion. You know, and I welcome those opinions. But see, the problem that I have, that I run into when I talk to some of these people or when I hear them talk, there's this term called cognitive dissonance that sets in. you talk to them and you explain to them why their position is illogical or it's a non sequitur, it doesn't follow, and it's like their brain locks up and they do a reboot and go, more gun control, more gun control. I actually heard the musket argument today online during the preceding show. The musket argument. But, I mean, is that really what you have? Is that the best you got?
I mean,
the musket argument.
I mean, I would clarify that entire train of argument as being called stuck on stupid. That's just, you know, and I don't mind if I'm offending people. You know, this gentleman went through, and how many, Rick, let me ask you a question, because I think you'll know the answer to this. How many gun laws are there in America?
There are at least 20,000 gun laws on the books.
So with 20,000 gun laws on the books, this guy still did what he did. And he turns around and they want to put more gun laws on the books?
Yeah. You know, maybe that 20,000th and one law make a difference. But we're about to take a break. We will welcome you on the other side of it. Please make note of the number, because me and Jared, we got a lot to talk about. We're going to quarterback and dissect this thing until you all understand the errors in your logic. 313-209-9000. And we're back. You are tuned in to Does It Make Sense on 910 AM, the Superstation. Don't adjust your radio, because sitting in for Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas is yours truly, Rick Ector. And I'm joined by my buddy, my man, Jared Maynard.
And your co-host. That was for you.
Oh, okay, for me. Now we're officially co-hosts. Hey, y'all, I don't know if you all heard the first segment, but Jared has now officially at least acknowledged me as co-host, because we had this little rivalry thing going on as to who was actually the host in the absence of Rocky. But
all I'm going to say, at 4:30 this afternoon, I said, did you call Rick Ector the co-host? He said, oh, that's a good idea.
Well, yeah, as long as you give me at least 4 hours lead time, I can probably move some things around and make it happen. But let's go back to this incident, this tragedy, this atrocity that occurred this past weekend. A couple of things you hit on a few moments ago, Jared. And one, I'm going to go directly back to this acknowledgement of differing ideas. And I think we can carry that concept even further beyond just ideas, thoughts, and political positions. I could carry it to other rights. And there's another right that's really central and key to this discussion, the one that our ideological foes are focusing on, and that's the Second Amendment to the United States Constitution. If you, for whatever reason, just don't like guns, you don't like firearms,
don't have to own one.
The whole thing just makes you weak in the knees and makes you ill and sick. You know what? Don't buy one. Don't. I tell you what, I have assumed a greater level of responsibility for my personal protection. And you know what? I carry a firearm everywhere I may legally do so, just in case I need it to defend myself. And if I need it to defend myself, if I'm in a supermarket and I'm minding my own business and I'm buying goods and stuff and some crazed lunatic comes in and he's saying, I'm doing this for ISIS and I'm taking all of you out because I don't like you. You know what? I'm going to defend myself. And I'm going to do the very best job that I can to take you out. And if you're there, you know what? By me being there and you don't like guns, well, as a side benefit, guess what? Your life has been protected and your life has been spared. All I ask is that you at least exercise some common courtesy and recognize my constitutionally recognized right to keep and bear firearms.
Whoa, you're asking a little bit.
I'm going into dangerous territory.
Huh? can get you a safe space, get a little bubble around you or something, you know. But you're absolutely right. You know, we have certain rights. They are granted to us by God. The first 10 amendments to the Constitution were put there by the founders. They were put there. And they have stood 240 years, and we have a right to bear arms, and we have a responsibility to do it responsible, which I know you do, which I'm about to join you in doing here very shortly. And we should be – I don't think anybody should – if, like you said, if you have a problem with owning a gun, don't own one.
Don't own one. Don't
please
buy
don't.
One. Right.
Don't even buy a toy gun.
Right.
But those of us who are responsible gun owners – those of us who have taken the safety class of us, those of us who work hard to maintain it, just because you don't like it doesn't give you the right to tell me I can't have one.
And I like that you brought that up, because it's a very poignant point that I think needs to be stressed. And you talked about taking the training, because here in the state of Michigan, people who desire to get a concealed pistol license or a concealed carry license, they have to take an 8-hour training course. And it just so happens, you know, that you have to also get a background check to make sure that your criminal history is up to snuff. And by up to snuff here in the state of Michigan, it is more stringent. The rules, your criminal background history is more stringently vetted than for a law enforcement officer here in the state of Michigan. And you know what? This guy in Florida, he passed the background check, and he got a concealed pistol license. Imagine that. An Islamist jihadist passed the background check because he hadn't slaughtered people before. So for his first slaughter, he went to a pistol-free zone. And you know what? Since he could pass the background check and he got a license, he actually bought some guns, and, yeah, he used them. And people are like, what can we do? I guess we should ban guns, and that way anyone who could pass a background check can't get a gun, and then we'll protect ourselves. And I'm like, well, gee, do you really think that a bad guy who is committed to destroying America and our way of life and your tolerance of alternative lifestyles, do you really think that's going to stop this madman from committing these crimes? And I'm here to tell you, the answer is a resounding no.
Oh, I think it's a resounding something, 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 no. I'm not sure what I can legally say on the radio.
Keep it family friendly. It is after 8 o'clock. You know, I remember when I was a kid, that little eyeball for Channel 2 would come on, you know, and it'd be like, hey, it's 8 o'clock. Do you know where your children are, right?
Mm-hmm.
Nowadays, they don't even run that commercial, you know, I guess.
Well, I don't know. Maybe that's a condition of our culture where we're just so sensitized.
A sign
to it
of
all.
The change in times, right?
Yeah, but yeah, you know, with your point, it's we have a lot of people doing a lot of things these days and screaming mad and talking about what's important. I just am tired of not hearing any of them talk about what is their right, what is given to them by God, our Creator, and in our Constitution, and from each people. We don't see them talking about their ability to, take away their First Amendment right, which allows them to say we shouldn't have a Second Amendment right.
You know what? There's a movement afoot to actually start infringing upon the First Amendment right. I think it was a bunch of journalists that got all butthurt. Can I say butthurt on the air?
Rocky's going to tell me tomorrow if you can or can't. If the FEC shows up with a bill and Kevin's like, y'all need to pay this, Rocky. Going right to you.
They seriously had a pain in their posterior when journalists who wanted to cover the upcoming primary party conventions, right? And the Secret Service wanted these journalists to submit to a background check. These guys were up in arms. How dare you guys want to conduct a criminal background check on us when we're trying to exercise our First Amendment right to cover the news for the American public? And
well,
you know what?
First, there's nobody in the mainstream media that covers the news. If you would have said makes the news, makes up the news, any of those items, I would have gone through and agreed with.
Right.
Because, you know, if they're just simply reporting this person said this person said that,
right,
you decide, it would be a different solution here to the process. But, you know, they don't like to be told how they're covering news. And, you know, again.
So it's only a small shift to say, okay, all right, maybe you journalists, you got your feelings hurt because you were asked to pass a background check before you were allowed the opportunity to get your press credentials to demonstrate and to exercise your First Amendment, right? Maybe you know how us responsible, law-abiding gun owners feel. Maybe now you know some of the angst that we experience when you guys come on, you know, these TV shows and radio shows and tell us that we need to sacrifice our right. And one of the other things that you brought up earlier that I was glad that you brought up, Jared, was the fact that they were in this nightclub, which by statute in Florida law, you know, there's a requirement that they can't defend themselves. And yes, this guy walked in with a couple of firearms, one long arm, one handgun, and he shot, you know, over 100 people. So, you know, regardless of the hype that you hear from these anti-gun folk, he didn't walk in there with a big giant 103-round magazine.
He did not. But let's talk about that for a second. If I was a parent, this is the first question I would be asking. How did that gun get through the front door? I said it slow so everybody can understand it.
How did it get through the door?
You got a bouncer who's checking IDs, making sure charge and cover. How did that get through the door? I'm not casting any dispersions on anybody. That's the first question I want to know. The second question I want to know is, was there an accomplice? I'm reading online there was. If there was, who was it? Let's hope they catch him.
Yeah, let's hope they catch him, and let's hope that they do their due diligence and figure out how it happened. You know, and these should
send them to Guantanamo and, you know, let them do the due diligence down there.
You know, these investigations, you know, I don't want to say they become routine, but, you know, it's the FBI. They know what they're doing, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we had a big-time investigation after the terrorist attacked in San Bernardino, right? Man and wife team. They were, I guess, a sleeper cell for ISIS, and they had some planning and things that were going on, and for whatever reason, something happened at a baby shower at work, right? And
mm-hmm.
they flipped out and just decided, okay, we're going to do it now. Let's just shoot up everybody in this work environment and let's see what happens. And there was a big investigation after that. But obviously, because we've had this situation play out in Orlando, Florida, maybe the lessons learned cannot be transferable to future events. You have a small work cells that are in play, and we can't catch the small fish like we can a big organized cell. But check this out.
I just really hope when they find those people and they find the answers to their questions that it's dealt with in a manner that is worthy of us, that it's done
right,
with correction.
Let's break for a commercial. We want everyone to stay listening. Text your friends and tell them that we are on live 9:10 a.m. the Radio Superstation, and we will be right back after these messages. And we're back. It's time for the weather break. Hey, Jared, what's the temperature in the forecast?
Well, if I open up the studio door, it's quite warm.
Oh, come on now. We need to be a little more specific.
We want a little more specific. It is currently 64 degrees Fahrenheit with an expected low of 58 degrees, with partly cloudy with some showers tonight and partly cloudy tomorrow. Winds are at 9 miles from the east and humidity at 53% and precipitation at 50%. Weather has been brought to you by Weather Vision.
And we are back. You know, we want to know.
Go ahead.
Does it make sense?
I think I'm making a lot of sense, and that's scaring me.
To you. You're listening to the Superstation, 9:10 a.m. Radio Our Way. You know, we're here live every Monday from 9 p.m. to 11 p.m. And usually you hear Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas. Oh, look, he put a phonetic key in the show notes. and Karen Dumas. But today is Rick Ector and my main man, my co-host. Let me say that again. My co-host.
Don't push it.
Jared Maynard. All right. Oh, once again, just in case you're listening to this dialogue we're having about the heinous act that occurred in Orlando, Florida, you want to chime in and share with us your thoughts, your opinion, you can call in on the number at 313-209-9000, 313-209-9000.
Now, Rick, now normally I don't get my news from MSNBC, but for some reason it's up in the station room here. Mm-hmm. And Christopher Hayes, and so everybody knows who this is, I'm just going to read one of his tweets. Christopher Hayes is the host of All In with Christopher Hayes on MSNBC, which is weeknights at 8 p.m., and he says he's editor-at-large at The Nation, and he's a Cubs fan. Well, good for him.
Yeah.
Okay. But anyhow, he made a tweet that I was watching while we were at the break, and this is he's just reporting as he learns this stuff. So he said, Kevin West said the shooter, 29-year-old Omar Mateen, contacted him 3 months ago through a dating app called Jacked. He was saying things like, what clubs are popping, and things sort of, what are good places to go? And this is being reported on the news. So we're starting to get more of this story where this supposed guy who's, you know, upset about two men kissing, you know, he's on a dating app now, according to this journalist. Again, it paints me.
Dating app. You know, that just goes to show how old I am, man. These dating apps they got, like Tinder and Grindr and all these other.
Apparently Jacked.
Jacked? Is that a new one?
I'm just reading it. Apparently Jacked.
All right. Let's take a call. We have a caller. Mr. Rick. Rick, are you on the line with us?
Yes, I am. How are you doing today?
Hey, great, sir. How are you?
Just fine. Wonderful conversation you guys are having.
Hey, thanks, man. Thanks. What's on your mind?
This whole thing about this shooting, of course, troubles everyone. But I've never heard, and maybe I know the investigation is just starting, but I've never heard of anyone calling 911 to proclaim their allegiance to anybody before they start shooting. I really would like to have them release that 911 call about ISIS. If you think about it, anybody can do anything and say, blame it on ISIS. Hey, I'm an ISIS sympathizer. I'm doing this. You know, I'm beating up the neighbors because of ISIS. You know, I'm an ISIS sympathizer. Anybody can do that. So I know the investigation is new, but that's what they're saying. Mm-hmm. But it would really be interesting to find out if that was really what he did. That was an ISIS sympathizer. From what they said, he wasn't even a Middle Eastern guy. He was a guy who was a Latino guy.
I heard his parents were Afghani. They came from Afghanistan, and he's like first, you know, generation U.S. So,
that's what I'm saying. So I'm just saying, and of course, by arming ourselves, we're actually, I'm not sure we're part of the problem or we're going to be part of the solution. As I always say, no gun, no problem. If he wasn't able to get a gun in the first place, this problem would not exist. So, and, you know, to carry a gun around and say, hey, if something like that happens, a CCW gives me the ability to carry a gun but not the ability to shoot it. A lot of people don't understand that.
Sounds like chicken and the egg
problem.
It's
like the gunfight at OK Corral, where we're promoting guns when we really should be promoting peace.
I don't think we're promoting guns. I think we're promoting freedom, and we have the right to carry a gun. And we're simply saying that, you know, if this situation were to happen, and you know, I'm in the supermarket with Rick, I'm certainly safer than I am in a supermarket where this is happening, where nobody has one.
Oh, I appreciate that. And like you said, it's a hypothetical. We probably got a better chance of hitting the lottery is that happening, but that's like I said, that's a hypothetical thing too. But the Second Amendment right was written 240 years ago when they had muskets and attack muskets and dueling pistols, doesn't do anything to about. They didn't mention, you know, military style weapons and things like that. So the Second Amendment rights are good, but they're old. They should be changed. They should be made to make it work in modern day society. That's all.
Yeah. I can take that.
Something that's 240 years old.
Well, the freedom of speech is 240 years old. You know, back in the day,
and that's been changed many times.
Well, I mean, there's certain allowances for what I guess they call hate speech, right? That's an issue.
Well, there's 20,000 reasons or 20,000 different ways we've changed the Second Amendment too.
Yeah, and I'm not even going to go into that. But you know, that whole musket argument, I've always viewed as being rather dubious. I mean, did we really need the Supreme Court to tell us that we can express our thoughts and opinions over the internet because the founding fathers didn't have Wi-Fi hotspots? Do we really need that? And when we talk about the type of firearms were available of that day, in that day, the regular everyday citizen had the same type and style of firearms that our U.S. military had. And that's primarily for the reason why we have the Second Amendment. I'm going to go into the Second Amendment in just 1 second, but here's the point that I wanted to get at when you say that, you know, they had these muskets. I mean, that was the technology of the day. You know, I don't know if you're into the Bible, but, you know, Luke 22 and 36, you know, Jesus told his disciples, you know, the apostles, said, "Hey, do you have a sword?" And they said, "No." He said, "Well, sell your cloak and get one." And then they brought the swords, and he said, "Okay, that's enough." The swords were the weapons of their day. So I don't really think that we really can take seriously the argument that the Second Amendment only applies to muskets. I really don't. Because at the end of the day...
Right, but I understand, but the problem is the Second Amendment has... guns have caused far more trouble than they've ever saved. So, I mean, the gun thing is, of course, to me, in my mind, they're just making money. They don't really care much about the welfare of the people around. They're just making money. They're making too much money as far as something that we can turn off and stop.
Well, there's some very...
Let's face it. They're big business.
Everything is big business in this country, whether we're talking about medical marijuana, or we're talking about the automobile industry, or we're talking about predatory lending in urban environments. I mean, it's all the same thing. We all make money in a capitalistic society. But here's the thing as it relates to the Second Amendment. The Second Amendment was designed, whether you think it's antiquated or it's a notion that will never happen here, even though it happens everywhere else, it was there as a last-ditch provision to ensure that if our government ever turned tyrannical, that we as citizens would have a right to put down those despots and those tyrants and reclaim our freedom, okay? That's why we have the Second Amendment. And
now, what I heard about the Second Amendment, I hear what you're saying, too. I heard about the Second Amendment. It was made, actually, for the slaves. When the slaves were at their homes and the lynch mobs would come out and it would prevent them from owning guns so they could shoot back and they can defend themselves. That's what I hear.
There were a lot of gun laws. The first gun laws that were put on the book, as a matter of fact, and I'm glad you brought this up, the very first gun laws came out was to make sure that recently emancipated slaves could exact no reprisals against their former slave owners. And as a matter of fact, it's only been within the state of Michigan since January 1st of 2001 that we struck down a couple of Jim Crow laws off our books, which came out of the Ossian Sweet case back in 1925 here in the city of Detroit. And that's a long story. I want to go into that. But with regards to whether you believe the Second Amendment is antiquated or not, let me just say this.
No, it is, I think we're better off without guns. Guns, I'm against guns. There's too many people who die from self-inflicted wounds. There's too many people who die from homicide, suicide, all kinds of stuff. Guns. I mean, there's a few people who defend themselves. I mean, very, very, very few. But most of the time, it's people who are shot. And, you know, policemen are often shot, and they have guns. So I'm just against guns. Guns
and that's
cause far more problems than they have. The statistics go along with it.
30,000
people die every year from gun violence. And out of that gun violence, maybe 200 people get shot because of their...
I don't know if the stats are that way. Since we're going to talk about stats, I mean, far more people die from automobile accidents and doctor mistakes, and nobody's calling for the...
Well, automobiles weren't made to... Can you ride to the store on your gun? Automobiles were made for different reasons. Guns were made to kill and injure. That's what
was there not a case just the other day?
They do.
Was there not a case just the other day where a person misused an automobile and ran over a group of bicyclists and killed at least five people on bicycles? Yeah, all right. Rick, you want to hang on for after the break and continue this conversation?
I sure will. 90 people were killed by guns on that same day, too. Okay, go ahead. I'll wait.
Let's take a break. follow us online, social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. We'll be right back in a few moments. And we are back. Cha-ching. You are listening to Superstation 910 AM Radio Arway. We want everyone stay listening. Tell all of your friends that we are live on 910 AM radio station. Normally, this show is hosted by Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas. Today, sitting in for that dynamic duo is me, Rick Ector, and my cohort, my co-host.
There you go again,
Jared,
with that
Maynard.
Word.
You having a phobia about that word. Listen to you. You know, we were supposed to give a shout-out to the pizza delivery guy from Hungry Howie's over there at 10 Mile and Losser, but Mr. Jarrett over here seemed to forgot the guy's name. It's called CRS. It's the second thing that goes when you get old. But
well, I did have my birthday on Monday, so I am feeling quite old these days.
We have another caller, too. So, Rick, we want you to hang out for a second. We'll let this other caller come on in, and Rick, we'll bring you back in a moment. But I believe we have Bob, correct? Bob, are you there?
Yes, I am. Rick, Jared, you guys are doing a great job, and I would say you're probably putting Karen and Rocky out of a job with the quality performance you're putting in.
I just want to make sure that Rocky is at home listening to this broadcast and actually hear this. Thank you so very much.
He's going to be coming home from his event. He's going to turn the U-turn and pull right here to the station to come in and sit down. Y'all ain't screwing with my show no more.
All right, Bob, what's your comment or question?
Well, when you don't, just the last thing on that, when you don't show up for work on time, this is what happens. You get replaced. So, but as far as the issue of guns, your last caller was talking about the gun violence. And again, when you see places that have consistently put in a lot of various rules for the handling of guns and having guns on the streets, et cetera, you look no further than Chicago, Illinois, which has all sorts of restrictions, et cetera, et cetera. It's supposed to be zone after zone and with guns rules, et cetera, et cetera. And they have incredible crime within the city, and it's people that are being harmed because there's just no ramifications. Nothing happens to these people because there's so many people that don't think twice about properly handling a gun. You have classes, CPL classes. I know out in our area we have places like the Sportsman's Complex where people go, Detroit Sportsman's, and the people go there and they learn everything about the safe handling of a gun. And guns do not kill people. Foolish people handling a gun do.
You know, I want to
– absolutely right.
I agree with him with his comment there. But, Bob, I think you hit on a point that I wanted to bring up. It's not guns killing people. A gun can sit here on the table between Rick Ector and I, and we'd probably look at it and maybe pick it up and feel it. Whether it's
I would
good
yell
for
at
us.
It, just test it. Give it a command. Be like, kill, kill, kill.
It'll just look at you like, please, okay.
Right.
But, you know, I think we've developed a society that doesn't have respect for life, where they think they just go around and, you know, be a gangster and pop, pop, pop and all this other. You know, and that's, you know, and that's what I'm just, I think if we had a lot more respect for life, then we probably wouldn't be, you know, seeing as many of these shootings.
Shootings, murders, robberies, rapes, carjackings, home invasions, you name it.
There are people out there, I bet you, that I'm sorry for interrupting you, my co-host. There are people out there, I bet, that, oh, I feel powerful. I have a gun. And that's the wrong way you should be feeling. You should be feeling, I have a responsibility in my hand. I have to take care of it. I have to be correct. And I don't think that's around. I think Bob's point is actually right.
Well, I'm not disagreeing with anything Bob's saying per se. I mean, I love the part where he talked about, you know, Chicago has always been a perennial hotbed for criminal behavior, especially crimes that are facilitated with the firearm. For years, I mean, for decades, Chicago has always been Exhibit A whenever we talk about whether additional gun laws will actually have an impact on criminal behavior. And you know what? We always pointed to Chicago and say, look, this is the place, well, one of the places, but the place in the Midwest where they have the most draconian gun laws in this area of the country, and yet and still, we still have outrageous, obscene numbers of robberies, rapes, home invasions, and carjackings. Hey, Bob, I want to thank you for your call, man. Appreciate it.
Is Rick still
here? Good afternoon, gentlemen.
All right.
Thanks.
Hey, Rick, you still there?
Yes, sir. I'm still here. I wouldn't hang up for the world.
and you know what?
It's too interesting.
And I appreciate you doing that. But before we went to the last break, you were talking about there being so many crimes, and you were wondering whether the cost benefit ratio, if you will, of owning a gun for self defense was actually worth it. And I'm here to tell you, if you look up the stats, and there's some very noted criminologists out there, such as Gary Kleck, and who's the guy with More Guns, Less Crime? Professor John Lott Jr. And what you will find is that there are over 2 million estimated defensive uses of a firearm for self-defense and personal protection. I can personally recount, anecdotally, several of my concealed pistol license students who have come back to me and said, you know what, Rick, I am so glad I took the class when I did. I am so glad that I got my CPL. And better yet, I am so glad I had it that night. So I really don't think that your argument about the negatives associated with criminal misuse of firearms outweighs the benefits of the vast numbers of people every year who are using firearms to defend themselves.
Okay, that's a stat that's, you know, yet to be proven, but the proven stat
is 33,000
people are killed every year. 33,000 people are killed.
Yes,
and you know what? I can tell you, I'm glad you sit down. I have a guy, I know somebody who did not shoot anyone, but he discharged a weapon in the presence of a police officer. I mean,
that's not a good idea.
How the case went.
We're going to put him in the stupid column.
To be honest with you, he didn't shoot anybody, didn't kill anybody.
There's
a
law against
that. He discharged a weapon in the presence of a police officer. And this was he's still in jail, and this happened in 1973. I am not kidding you.
Well, I'm sure there's probably some other extenuating circumstances.
Years.
I'm sure there's some other extenuating circumstances there. But it goes back to the argument, to the stat that I gave you earlier about there being all of these gun laws on the books, over 20,000 gun laws. Let me tell you, there's a gun law for discharging a firearm within city limits. There are some people that get up in arms when someone is approached.
He was in Western Michigan when he did that.
You know, that woman in Florida.
He's been there since 73. Yeah.
You remember that woman in Florida where she was being abused by her husband, and then she got a gun to defend herself instead of shooting her husband, who was putting her in an imminent threat of great bodily harm, sexual assault, or death? She decided to show the gun and brandish it and start shooting at the ceiling, and now she got 20 years in prison for that. And everyone was like, my God. She didn't shoot anybody. She didn't hurt anybody. Well, the operative point is that it's illegal and you cannot do that. When you just randomly discharge bullets, the law of gravity is applicable. Whatever goes up must do what?
Must go down.
And it will come down and it presents a clear and present danger to anyone around you. And I would suggest, even though I know this crime that you were telling us about your buddy, who get this, not only discharged a gun in the city, but he did it in front of the police. If there's ever a person...
He was in Western Michigan. He was in Western Michigan.
I don't think it matters whether it was Eastern Michigan, though.
Right, I don't think you should be discharging
firearm
at all.
I know all the points we've made, and both of us have made some real good touches in this conversation. But the point is, you have to admit, if there's no gun, there's no problem.
Well, Cain slew Abel, right?
Like that.
Wait a minute. No, 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 no.
Cain slew Abel,
listen,
right?
Listen, the problem in Orlando wasn't that there was a gun. The problem that I see in Orlando is that there was some crazy guy who doesn't like guys kissing guys, and he decided to go out and do something. That was the problem in Orlando. You know, and to say that there's...
It wouldn't be a problem.
You don't think that he would have blew the place up?
But you know, you can take away the guns to every legal citizen who has obtained them legally, who has done everything and done that we had to do correctly. But then you turn around, there's still going to be guns. You know, the laws aren't for the criminals. They don't follow them anyhow. I mean, they're going to get their guns. I mean, that's... I'm sorry. The idea to say that if there was no guns, there'd be no crime? Come on.
Right. That's hype. That's all hype. Hypothetical or hype. It means nothing. These guys got guns, and they've always had guns. Now, look back 30 years when there wasn't many guns on the street. You say, you're right.
Oh, man, it's always been guns on the street.
Guns don't kill people. People kill people. That's
correct. And it's always been people killing people.
The more people are killed by those guns, that's the problem.
No, it's not. There are about 300 million... firearms in circulation today, and there's about 95 million gun owners. The numbers of people who are criminally misusing firearms as a sample, as a fraction of the total population, is extremely tiny and minuscule. As a matter of fact, violent crime rates all across the country have been steadily decreasing nationwide, all over the country. And you know what? The crime rate is still trickling down. What we find is that we have intractable social issues in play, particularly in our urban areas, in which there are other factors that are in play, such as people not raising people, raising animals, not instilling any morals and values and respect for life. That's the problem that we have in our society today.
But Brother Rick,
and I appreciate that, but also the stats, you have another stat too. How many people are in jail for using guns? How many people have been killed by using guns? In the last 3 years in America, more people were killed by guns than in the entire Vietnam War. Now, that's a stat.
I'm not sure about that.
Look it up.
Okay, well, you know, we got the internet. We'll check it out.
Killed in Vietnam, but almost 90,000 Americans killed by gunfire in the last 3 years.
But you're comparing an armed war to what's happening civilian-wise.
Okay, I'm comparing stats. You say stats.
Vietnam, we're talking about a war, right?
Do you know what I like about this conversation?
Right, right. You're saying, if you just give me a stat about how many people were, you know, helping each other with guns and avoiding criminal persecution. But are we looking at, if there was a problem in your country that 33,000 people look at that. And that's exactly what's going on.
Hey, Rick, I'm not cutting you off, buddy. I'm just asking you to hang on because we got to pay some bills. So. You want to come back after this break?
Call back,
you don't have to call back, man. Just hang on.
I appreciate it. I appreciate the time.
Thanks, Rick.
Rick, as my namesake, I truly wish you a great night. We just disagree on guns. But have a great night, Rick.
Hey, we'll get together soon. I appreciate you taking my call. Have a great evening.
All right, buddy. Hey, we want everyone to stay listening. Text your friends. We're about to take a break. You're listening to the SuperStation 910 AM radio our way. We'll be right back on the other side of this break. We're back. You're listening to SuperStation 910 AM radio our way. Good evening. You're tuned into Does It Make Sense with Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas. The dynamic duo is not here. So you have us, the JV, Rick Ector, and my, get this, co-host is Mr. Jared Maynard.
Oh, boy.
Remember, your opinion matters. We talked with Rick and Bob today. Is anybody else out there? Your opinion matters. And believe it, you know what? Even if you don't believe in the Second Amendment, hey, I need some practice. Come on in and tell me why you hate guns. Give us a call at 313-209-9000. Right now, I want to make one last point on guns, and then I'm done with it unless somebody wants to call and say something else.
Can I just
With your last point on guns? Give me your last point on guns.
It's just not about guns. I really like this conversation because I finally found somebody like my co-host.
We're having a problem with this word,
we're
right?
We're having a problem
with the word. Do you like partner better?
No, no. And don't call me sweetie either. But here's what we're using our First Amendment right to discuss an issue, and nobody who's called in, and neither of us really need to go outside and have a safe space and cry about it.
No, of course not.
I mean, so you know.
Put on a big boy pass and go to work.
That's right. Bring it on. That's my point.
Okay.
But you've been doing a lot of safe space invading tonight.
I've been violating safe spaces?
That's right.
I'm the safe space violator.
Well, yeah. That's good to know.
My whole thing about that argument, and I believe it was Rick that brought it up. You know, Rick says, hey, it's an antiquated amendment. It was 240-something years ago. Well, my standard answer to that is very simple. The United States Constitution clearly outlines a way in which we can repeal amendments to the Constitution, okay? It's real simple. Mm-hmm. All you need to do is get 2/3 of all the states, and I don't have my calculator handy. What's 2/3 of 50? Get 2/3 of the states together. It's like 37, 38.
38.
Get 2/3 of the states to come together and say, you know what? The Second Amendment is no longer relevant. It doesn't apply.
33.
We don't need guns. We trust that our government will never become tyrannical. We are confident that bad guys from other countries won't invade our homeland. We're confident that all of these things will never happen. And you know what? We just love our government, and we know that they will always love us back. And if that's how we get 33 states to believe that, then you know what? Fine, because that's the system that we agreed to follow, the U.S. Constitution. Mm-hmm. And until you can get 33 states, and there's a whole lot of states in the South, I know you don't have a chance of getting the Second Amendment repealed. But if you can get 33 states to say, okay, we don't need guns, it's passe, we rather live, you know, European style, where even the mere thought of self-defense is illegal and outlawed. You don't have a right to defend yourself over in Europe. Okay, so that's my last take on that. So as I was looking through my timeline earlier today on my favorite social media spot of choice, I could not help but see that the Detroit Lions have announced for this season, 2016, they're going to have, get this, cheerleaders. Ooh, cheerleaders.
Let me just volunteer my services to help them select the cheerleaders. If anybody from the Lions organization is listening, please call me at work or call the station. I'd be more than happy to sit through the HR process to make sure that you select good, cheerful cheerleaders to cheer on our Lions.
Well, okay, I'm going to play along here. You know, I'm going to play along and see.
Okay.
See if you hurt yourself. Let me play along right here. Exactly. Let's imagine you have a clipboard in your hand, okay? You left hand in the right hand.
We're not going to imagine nothing.
No. See, you went totally off the rails.
This safe space is not being invaded.
Look, you have a clipboard and an ink pen and a blank sheet of paper. I don't know where you were going, okay? Anyway, as you're evaluating the Detroit Lions cheerleading staff, give me 5 characteristics that you would need to evaluate and rate to determine which ladies get selected to be the Detroit Lions. Well, you call them Lionettes or Lionesses?
I don't know what they would call them.
The Detroit Kitty Cats? What would we call them? Well, that first thing would be to give them a name. But okay, we'll pass the whole naming thing for right now. For right now, give me your top 5 variables that you would assess to determine which ladies get to be a part of the Detroit Lions cheerleading squad.
I am going to leave that up to the Detroit Lions. Ford family is unwavering in their commitment to improving the Detroit Lions fan experience on and off the field. Now, we're getting cheerleaders. That's great. Maybe we can talk a little bit about on the field now and, you know, contending for a Super Bowl. Oh, I said it.
Did you say Super Bowl?
I just said it.
For real, did you say Super Bowl?
I mean, you know, I'm just saying.
And are you telling me that increasing the fan experience with cheerleaders is going to help us get to a Super Bowl? Is that what you're saying?
You know, I'm reading – ESPN did a great article on this, and it's like the fourth time I've read it because this is an exciting experience.
You read it four times. I'm sure there was something good in there.
Well, I'm telling you, we have the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders, and there's like the Steelers have cheerleaders, and I can't remember the four other teams that have cheerleaders. So we're a part of a pioneering group that are bringing cheerleaders.
We're on the leading edge.
Well, we are on the leading edge, but it's also good to note that there is a group of cheerleaders now. I think it's called the Detroit Pride or something like that.
Okay.
That are just volunteering. They go to the game and they sit in one section and they act like cheerleaders throughout the game. And it's not just regular fans. They have a whole website dedicated or Facebook dedicated to themselves.
Okay, so if we have these ladies already doing it, why do we need an official one then?
I don't know. I'm not the Detroit Lions president and CEO.
Okay, let's pretend that you were the Detroit Lions CEO for a day, and you got a chance to outline your vision for this cheerleading squad for the Detroit Lions organization. Okay. What five variables are we evaluating? Are we evaluating how, I don't know, whether do they have to be a certain height?
You're digging this hole yourself. I am just sitting back. Need some dirt? Let me know.
See, you don't think that I can behave myself talking about cheerleaders?
You, sir.
I think I'm pretty well disciplined. I mean,
you know, this is going to add an exciting dynamic to going to the football team. We're going to be one of seven people with cheerleaders coming down and having a great time at the thing. And one of the reasons I know this is going to be a plus. Because if you read in the article, they hired the woman, and I'm going to make sure I get her name. Her name is Rebecca Gerard Smoker, They hired her because she did the automotion for the Pistons, the automotion dance team.
Right.
So
the choreography is going to be tight, you said.
Well, I'm just telling you that I think they're taking a first great step. They want to have cheerleaders. They hired somebody who has got multiple years of experience in bringing cheerleading teams and cheerleading environment, and I think it's going to change something. And I think it's we got to do something because,
you know what?
I don't know if you watched the Lions game lately, but
I don't admit to it publicly because publicly I've sworn off on the team ever since they went 0-16 that one year. Right then, that pretty much did it for me personally. You know, I was like, if they don't care, you know what? No matter how bad your team is in this age, this perennial age of parity. Mm-hmm. You should at least be able to luck up and just win one game. If you really, really try, if you really, really try each and every game to try to win, even if you have a bad team, you will luck up and win one that you shouldn't win.
You know, again, to be a Detroit Lions fan, you know,
it's got to know misery.
It takes some dedication. And I know there's people out there who have, you know, better things, and I know we started off a little bit, a little joking about the segment, but this is something I really think is going to bring an element to our team and to our game that only six other teams have.
You know what I want to see the Detroit Lions do that will enhance my enjoyment of the game?
Lower the ticket prices?
I would like to see more first downs.
More touchdowns?
I like to see more catches. Oh. I like to see how they're going to replace Megatron. I like to see if that offensive line is going to give
all right. You know
Matt
what?
Stafford time to throw.
You've just decided to put this in drive and go into every safe place you possibly can. Okay, it's a building block situation with the Detroit Lions.
So now while we're building this team, let's distract everybody from what's important by bringing out some cheerleaders. Maybe we won't realize that we didn't make the playoffs again.
Have we made the playoffs since Wayne Fonts was in?
Or we made the playoffs, we lost, right?
Oh, that's right. I remember when Chris Christie was hugging Jerry Jones. I remember.
We're way early, but since we're talking about cheerleaders and increasing, you know, the fan experience, just offhand, do you think they're going to make the playoffs this year?
I would always like to hope that they would.
You're hedging, you're stalling. Come on, we got a break. Are they going to make the playoffs this year?
After the break, we'll continue that.
Jared punted yet again. Tell you what, we have a commercial break. We're telling you, hey, stick around, and we'll be right back, and we'll get Mr. Jared Maynard's prognostication. Yeah, I know it's a big one, isn't it? Yeah, about the Lions' chances next year.
Yep.
So stick tuned. Stay tuned. And we're back. We want to know, does it make sense to you? You're listening to Superstation 910 AM Radio, our way. You know, we are live every Monday night from 9 p.m. to 11. And usually you hear Mr. Rocky Raczkowski and Miss Karen Dumas. But today, the JV is here. You're listening to me, Rick Ector, and my co-host, Mr. Jared Maynard. We want everyone to tell all of your friends, tweet them, text them, inbox them, Facebook them. Tell them Rick and Jared's on. Rocky is gone tonight. The kids are having a blast, and we want to hear from you at area code 313-209-9000. And right before the break, I was taunting my co-host Jared with his guess for the Lions this year. I didn't even ask him what their record was going to be. We were talking about the whole cheerleader thing and enhancing the fan experience, and I just asked him very simply where they're going to make the playoffs this year with the cheerleaders.
Listen, this is your thing, but when you go and you see a Pistons game and what the automation and the Pistons cheer team, I don't know what they call them, they put on a really good show that's really exciting for the fans to go and see. And I think if you can transport that to the Lions organization, which I think they've gone the right way of doing it by hiring the lady who did the automation, it's a good start, and it could bring a lot of value to the Detroit Lions.
I would tell you this. If they are a winning organization mm-hmm. and they have a cheer team, you know what? Yeah, that could enhance the actual fan join experience. But you know what? If we're getting blown out and then they bring out the cheerleaders at halftime, you know what? I'm not going to forget that I forked out a lot of money to the game to watch these guys play football and embarrass themselves.
You know, I'm just going to say, because I'm going to give you what you want, because you are my co-host. But I'm going to preface it by...
Yes or no, Jared, they're going to make the playoffs.
I'm going to preface it by saying this.
What's up?
If Senator Marco Rubio from Florida becomes the director of player personnel or the president of the Miami Dolphins,
nah.
Man, you know I'm going to buy a Dolphins jersey, and it's going to have Rubio on the back of it, and I'm going to be a Dolphins fan. And he's not even throwing a football. Okay, so to answer your question... Hometown team, man, right. I'm going to start the optimism now. Super Bowl.
Super Bowl. You said the S word.
Super Bowl. I know we see the memes out there with the two Lions looking at that. What's that, Dad? It's a Super Bowl. Right. We never see those, son.
Okay.
But you know what?
Super Bowl.
Okay. I'm going to go for it.
Super Bowl victory?
Super Bowl.
Or just the Super Bowl appearance?
Listen, I'd settle for them to be in the Super Bowl, and if they won... You know, it's going to be such an occasion if they win the Super Bowl. So why not just start every season by saying, this is our year? The Cubs did it, and they made it to the World Series.
Man,
it was finally their year. It only took them, like, I don't know, 30 years.
Even if I really thought that they were going to make the Super Bowl, I wouldn't even put them out there like that, because at the end of the season, you know.
You've got to look on the good side of things. Don't get me pessimistic.
You know, speaking of pessimism, I have a very pessimistic subject that I like to bring up. You know, I was perusing my timeline today at my social media site of choice.
Wait a minute. Before we go into your social media of choice, your predictions, sir, please, and thank you.
I predict that the Lions will not make the playoffs this year.
Well, one of us is going to be right and one of us is going to be wrong.
Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. You know. But anyway, all right.
Go for it.
In the spirit of this pessimism, right, you know, and I look at the state of local politics today, man, I saw a story that I really, you know, really felt bad about. Apparently, according to published reports, the city of Detroit's mayor, Mr. Mike Duggan, has thrown his endorsement behind Robert Ficano to be a judge.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What do you think? Judge Robert Ficano. Has he ever been a judge before? No. Has he ever practiced law before?
I think you have to practice 5 years before you can be a judge anyhow.
I don't think he's ever practiced law, and I don't know if we need another judge that's never been a lawyer before. And we haven't even got into the Wayne County Jail thing yet.
Listen, I'm not even going to get into the Wayne County Jail thing. I'm going to just say this. The people voted you out. Go into private sector life, please. The people did not want you. They overwhelmingly said no, and now you want to be a judge. And if you want to be a judge and you want me to talk about it, then we can go into the Wayne County Jail. Obviously, your judgment wasn't the best.
I see what you did there.
Yes, you know, a little wordplay. Because I think, you know, when it comes – this is something that really aggravates me is politicians who don't get the message. You know, I'll give you another example. In Macomb County, about 87% of the people voted down Proposition 1, the road tax that all the legislators want.
Right.
Well, what do the legislators do? We need taxes. So they go ahead and they raise them. I mean, the people literally, clearly spoke. You know it's not a bad idea because my dad and I obviously are on opposing sides of this political debate. Yes, my mother has to throw
just
up the
flag.
Just
this debate or just
period.
Total political party differences?
Period.
Okay.
Okay.
So we don't talk politics over at the holiday dinner.
Oh, no, we do not. Okay. We do not. He tries to get it in when he leaves. I'm hoping he's listening. He might call in a little bit. And, you know, we can, I don't know.
Does your dad listen to the show? Does he know you are?
I don't know. If you read my Facebook, he knows I'm on. But, you know, I always tell this story to people. You know this is a bad idea because normally I say no, no, no on every tax increase. I'm just a no. I'm no. Just don't even talk to me. It's a no.
Right. Your taxes, no.
Yeah, just do with what you
more
got.
More taxes,
okay?
No. No.
Okay?
No.
Less taxes? Okay, yes. All right. But more, no. So you come in. And even my dad was telling people this was a bad idea.
Wow.
Okay. I mean, and I just sat there and went, don't have to argue that one.
You know, the thing about that whole tax increase that really amazed me was that there's a lot of people that aren't really good at math, right? And so the sales tax is currently, what is it, 6%?
Yes, sir.
And I think they were trying to raise it, 1 cent, 7 cent?
Yep.
And people were saying, oh, man, it's only a 1% difference. I'm like, no.
It's only a cup of coffee.
A 1% change. It was like a 16% increase.
But, you know, this just ties in where I'm a younger individual. Obviously, I celebrated a birthday, which you have not said happy birthday yet.
Happy belated birthday, Mr. Jared Maynard. See, how young are you today?
We're not going to talk about that.
Oh, see, you must be up there. You must be as old as Rocky.
Well, Rocky's actually 13 years older than me.
Okay, so that puts you at least at 70.
I know. Yeah. I'm old enough. I got the gray hair in my beard. Notice I don't have a beard anymore.
All right. That's how you know when guys are getting old and they just shave the beard and the mustache.
That's right. It's just gone. But this point is very important. We're coming up on election season, mm-hmm. and if we keep putting in these politicians who just don't get it, who don't understand what the people are saying to them, who don't care about anything that we're talking about, we're doing our own self a disservice. And to the candidates, okay, speaking, you know, about the article about Mr. Ficano, and there's one in Macomb County. The people have said no. And if I could say the word I want to say, there'd be a preface to the word no.
Right. Don't say those words. Right.
You know, it's done. And you have to look at it, and it pains me because the mayor's done some good things. He really has. But –
Tell me why you think that does good things to go here to endorse Ficano.
I don't know.
What was that all about?
I don't know. I want to know. I mean, why? I have no clue. Why would you put yourself in that position?
Let me tell you. You know,
this isn't the political
his
payback
whole
system.
Handling of that jail project over there, right across the street from Frank Murphy, has a total fiasco. There was no oversight, no management. They went way over budget by, $50 million? and then they needed another $100 million to finish it before somebody said, hey, we need more money. And you know what? We don't have any money. This issue by itself could have bankrupted the county.
Mm-hmm.
And now we have, you know, two of Detroit's favorite billionaires, Goris and the Quicken guy. Gilbert.
Dan Gilbert, yep.
They offered to pay, what was it like? They lowballed. What was it like $50, $60 million?
Mm-hmm.
And we're like $150 million into this thing. So I guess if we went with that deal, we'd be out, what, $90 million? You know, yep. Sooner or later, this adds up to real money, you know?
I have a very good friend, and that person always told me when they're in Congress and they're spending money, oh, a billion here, a billion there, pretty soon it's going to be real money. And I'm just thinking, this is what they, you know, what goes in your mind when you're doing this stuff? You know, like in Macomb County, okay, this is a pet peeve of mine. In Macomb County, we have a race for public works commissioner. Okay, and this is something that's very important. Mark Hackel, a Democrat, has endorsed Candace Miller to run.
I didn't know that he was a Democrat.
Yes, he is.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Yes, Mark Hackel is a Democrat. Capital D.
He's over in Macomb, right?
Correct.
Okay.
We do have a few of those.
Okay.
We'll catch this one on the back.
All right. It's time for a break. We want everyone to stay listening. Text or tweet your friends and tell them that we are on the radio. Rick Ector, my boy Jared Maynard, 9 to 11 every Monday on 910 AM Radio Superstation. Radio our way. We'll be right back. Have our weather break, temperature, and forecast.
You got it, Mr. Co-host. It is currently 64 degrees Fahrenheit with an expected low of 58 degrees with partly cloudy with some showers tonight and partly cloudy tomorrow. Winds are currently at 5 miles per hour from the east and humidity is at 53% with precipitation chance of 50%. This weather is brought to you by Weather Vision.
Oh, man, I like your weather voice. It's so pleasant.
Thank you.
We're back.
Did you notice the theme song coming in?
Could it be any more appropriate? We're the bad boys of late night talk radio.
I wouldn't go that far.
We want you to know, does it make sense to you? You're listening to Superstation 910 AM, and usually you hear Mr. Rocky Raczkowski and Miss Karen Dumas, but today, sitting in for them is me, Rick Ector, and my co-host, Mr. Jared Maynard. He hates that co-host.
You know, I hate it because I called you to co-host the show with me, but that's okay.
So you want to be like host instead of co-host? There can only be one host?
Okay, no, we're
Is this a mutually exclusive proposition we're talking about here?
It's mutual. Well, let's talk a little bit about
Were talking before the break. You were talking about this thing in Macomb County, and you brought up Mr. Hackel's name, and you told me he's a Democrat in Macomb. And where were you going with that?
Well, you know, there's a reason we did Bad Boys, Bad Boys. I mean, it's not because we're the bad. What we are, you know, we're pretty good hosts. I think
we're pretty cool.
Yeah, you know. Well, I'll know tomorrow what Rocky thinks.
Well, you know.
But anyways, you know, there are, just like we talked about with Mr. Ficano and his lack of judgment, you know, makes him a bad actor in the political scene. Well, Mark Hackel, Democrat county executive in Macomb County, and the Democrat part is very important in a second here, because Mark Hackel has made it a point to say that he doesn't see the Democrat or Republican. He just sees good people needing to do good work. And he has made it a point to call out our public works commissioner by the name of Tony Morocco. And he has had some very pointed words regarding Mr. Morocco and the way Mr. Morocco conducts himself in the system. And he's gone as far as not in a radio interview with WJR and several other places on Mackinac Island. He's literally said that Tony Morocco does a pay-for-play system.
Okay, so exactly, okay, make it plain. What does pay-for-play mean?
It is really easy. What Mark Hackel is saying is that if you want to get a permit, the permits are on the left side of the conference table, and on the right side, my gosh, look, there's fundraising tickets.
Oh, well, you know what? That's a very serious allegation.
And Mark Hackel has been repeating it constantly about what happens. And I think what's important is that it's a Democrat calling out another bad actor, another Democrat taking this decision. So we've got bad actors that are floating around, not to mention there's billions of gallons of sewage, which, by the way, the Public Works Administrator is supposed to keep the water clean. Just saying.
You know, when I think of Hackel and the environment and the roads, when is it last summer when, I guess, if a really bad pothole was present in the county, he would, like, jump in his car and go over there and look at it. And then if the crews were coming, he would help pitch some of the tar and fill it in and patch it up.
You know, every...
Wasn't he the one that was doing that?
You know, first, just everybody listening out there, it's the call-in number is 313-209-9000. I'd like to know if we're making sense here. But when you have bad actors as politicians, to answer your question, he was helping the situation, okay? And we have a wonderful candidate against Tony Morocco in Macomb County. Very wonderful. She was Secretary of State. She's county treasurer. She's serving currently in Congress. And each time she's taken on a position of trust from the people, she's done what's right for the people. And she's done things that have made government, ready for it?
What's that?
Actually work for the people. Holy cow.
Is that about Candace Miller?
I'm talking about Candace Miller. You got it right.
You know, when I think about Candace Miller, man, with her background and her experience, why not have her run for governor?
Well, I'm not going to answer the governor question. I'm going to focus on public works.
Okay, well, maybe it doesn't have to be the governor question, but my point is this.
I'm punting again.
She had, yes, obviously, to the most casual observer, but I'm not saying that I personally wanted to be governor. My point is this. With her distinguished political background and experience, isn't that like an extremely local kind of assignment, like an election kind of thing?
No. You know what?
You're serving in Congress.
I get that question.
Isn't it a fair question? Isn't there like a normal progression,
It's a fair question. And you know, when she first said she was running for drain commissioner, you know, I was like, you are in the United States Congress. Only one spot is better on this earth, and it's 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Okay? You know, I was like many people. All right.
That's an inevitable question, isn't
it? Yeah, it is. But when we talk about... Because this is very passionate to me, when we have bad actors in government, people that are doing things wrong, people that have, according to Mark Hackel, are doing a pay-for-play. People like Bob Ficano want to be judge. Okay? I mean, I'm still chuckling about that. Okay? When we have these types of bad actors in the system, and we have somebody who wants to come home because, you know, contrary to popular belief, you're not supposed to come out on a stretcher from the United States Capitol. You're supposed to be a citizen legislature, go for a few years, and come home.
Oh, that's old school.
Yeah, you know, I'm just saying, you know.
They haven't done that in like centuries.
Yeah, well, you know, all right. But you have somebody of Candace Miller's stature. Now, take a look what's going on here.
Okay.
We've talked about this three times now. We talked about Flint water.
Yeah,
we talk about our water. We talk about the problems we're having with our water. Mm-hmm. We talk about the problems with aging infrastructure.
Yes.
I can think of no one better to handle those problems in Macomb County than Candace.
I'm not saying that she wouldn't do a great job. I'm sure she would. I'm just saying.
But she's gone through and she has changed every department that she's ever been in, and she's made government work for people. And one of the things – again, because Mr. Hackel has brought up a very, very good point.
Okay.
And people can research the articles. All right. We have in Macomb County, we have Lake St. Clair. Wonderful resource. We have the Clinton River. Mm-hmm. I'm a big kayaker now. I bought my first kayak for my birthday this past weekend. And, you know, I'm out doing my kayaking now, and it's fun.
I saw your picture. It was funny.
Well, a lot of people commented that it was Fat Man in a Little Boat, but –
I wasn't going there.
That's all right.
But you brought it up.
60 days. 60 days. We'll revisit that in 60 days. But, you know, what we have is such bad actors who do this pay-for-play, according to Mark Hackel, who allow billions of gallons of sewage to be dumped into our lake and just go, oops, well, that's what happens. No, that's not what happens. You're an elected official. You're hired to do a job, and you should do the job. And if you can't do the job, get out of the way and let somebody else who wants to do it, who has a passion to get it done, to make changes. And I think that's something that we all should be taking a look at this type of election and sit there and say, are these people getting the job done? And if you're applying for the job,
okay.
If you're running for, I don't care. You're running for Congress.
Okay.
What are you gonna do? We need to interview these people more and more. And we as the people need to stop these bad actors like, Tony Morocco, and as Mark Hackel has said, his pay for play and his dumping of raw sewage, that's got to stop.
Yeah.
We're only hurting ourselves. Well, if we keep answering the question, how long does it be until we figure out that we're part of the problem instead of solving the solution? Because at the end of the day, it's us, the people, that need to get rid of bad actors as politicians.
I agree. Show them the door. And hopefully when we put them out that they actually get the message, which isn't the case when we put Robert Ficano out as Wayne County executive. So he didn't quite get the message. I think he did a few things. And then he says he wants to be a judge. And then all of a sudden he gets Mayor Duggan to endorse him. And you know what the scary thing is? The scary thing is
people may vote him in.
Is that, you know how name recognition is like everything in politics?
It's not everything. It helps you a tremendous amount.
It helps you a tremendous amount. I think the people's familiarity with the name, they might not, make the right connections with the name. They might say, they might have heard all these negative stories about him and mentioned his name, but maybe all that stuff is in the background and all they keep hearing is Ficano, Ficano, Ficano. And now maybe they think that it seems familiar that it would be worthy of a vote. That's my worst nightmare.
It's up to us to keep sounding the alarm, to keep saying that, listen, you need to know about A, B, C, D, and E. This is where the difference of making the news and reporting the news is extremely important. We have to report. Listen, this is what Bob Ficano did. Listen, this is what Tony Morocco does. And this is, okay, we have to be on all these bad actors. We have to report this stuff and make it look that the way it is. And then let the people decide it. The people put them back in. Well, the people put them back in.
Oh, Jared, you're passionate. Hey, we're about to take a break. We'll be back on the other side of these promotional messages.
We are back, and we wanted to thank Rocky and Karen for turning over the mic to, well, as my co-host says, the JV team. I don't know where he got that from. But we wanted to wrap up a lot of stuff here and talk. And I know, Rick.
Man, you didn't even tell them our names.
Oh, man,
They've been out doing whatever all day, and they decided, hey, let me turn on the Rocky and Karen Dumas show and see what's going on. And he's like, hey, there's some weird voices there. Introduce us, man.
This is why I said Rocky should have called you. So, just in case, this show normally doesn't make sense with Rocky Raczkowski and his co-host, Karen Dumas. But today, it is Rick Ector and myself, Jared Maynard. And we've been talking live about Orlando. We've been talking about gun rights, Detroit cheerleaders. We've been talking about corrupt politicians, which is what our I shouldn't say corrupt. I'm sorry. That's such a bad word on me.
You invaded space, safe space. Safe space violation.
You know, safe space, I'm telling you.
Talked about Ficano running for judge and how Mayor Duggan has endorsed him. We got into Macomb County, right?
We started talking
about Hackel and Candace Miller, right?
Yes, we talked about those folks. And before, I know we have a caller.
Yeah, we need to go ahead and take this call. Yep. Caller, are you there? Caller? Hello?
Yes, I am.
Greetings and salutations. How are you this evening?
I am well. Yourselves, gentlemen?
Good, good. Are we making sense, or is Rick my buddy crazy?
I think I'm going to reserve that for a higher
punter. And the Lions bring out the punter, the caller on line one.
Punt.
Ooh, he shanked it.
Do you have a comment or question for us, sir? And I say sir because we haven't been properly introduced. What's your name?
My name is Christopher Morris, actually.
How are you doing today, Christopher?
I'm doing great, gents. I enjoy listening to your show and watching your antics on the internet. Please don't dance anymore.
That was our station guy last week trying to get us all to do the whip or the nay-nay or whatever. Oh, whatever. I don't know.
No.
At least
practice it before we do it on TV. So do you have a question or comment for us today, Christopher?
I do have a comment, actually. I'm actually running for Congress myself in the 9th District.
Okay.
And I think you guys hit the nail on the head when you look at a person's background. And you were talking about Macomb County. And I think you're right. Candace Miller does have a background and a passion for it. And I think you're spot on. And in this day and age, you got to look at a person's background and see what's going on and see if that background now fits the current circumstances because times change.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And people need to be changed out.
Well, since you're running in the 9th, tell us about you. I mean, you can't take a lot of time, but I mean, give me like your
45-second
elevator pitch.
All right. In a nutshell, I'm an Army and a Navy veteran. My areas of expertise in the Navy were anti-terrorism work and force protection. And in the Army, I did military intelligence. So I do have a deep knowledge of the current environment. I've been fighting this war on terror, basically, since 1997.
Okay, so you believe you have some unique qualifications to deal with this specter of jihadists who are wreaking havoc in our civilized society.
You know, I think that's a good point to bring him.
Yeah. We could use some assets that have some backgrounds in terrorism.
So Chris, tell us a little bit, just real quickly before we switch topics here. Tell us why. Why, Chris? Why are you running?
Well, I think when I came back home after many years, I saw I didn't like the way the direction the country was going, and I was concerned. You know, the American people, I think, they have a healthy fear out there about what's going to be going on. We saw what happened in Orlando, and we need to make sure that Americans know they have security and they're safe. And you got to fight the enemy. Not on the American shores, but off the American shores. And that's why people like myself, my brothers in arms, why we deployed.
Chris,
and I say brothers and sisters, so I think that's important.
Chris, we thank you for calling.
Real quick, Chris, like 5 seconds. If people want to research you and find out more information, how can they get a hold of you? Quick.
Excellent question. Appreciate the opportunity. They can go to my website, which is www.vote.com. VOTE Morse, my last name, MORSE.com. So votemorse.com. You can find more about me, find out more about specific issues, and learn a little bit more about my background.
All right, Chris, thanks for calling. Hey, and it's time for us to close the show. So I want to give a very resounding thank you to everyone who's been listening to us. Myself, Rick Ector, and my buddy Jared Maynard, we've been sitting in for Rocky Raczkowski and Karen Dumas. I believe they'll both be back next week with some very high-profile guests. Until next week, we want to thank...
No final thoughts from us?
Let's get to that in a second. We'll make the final thoughts final. We want to thank Kevin Adele, our gracious station owner, and most importantly, we want to thank you, the listeners. Until next week, we thank you. Last parting thoughts, Jarrett?
My last parting thought is when you talk to and interview these politicians, let's get rid of the bad actors. And if somebody says... We're going to take our rights away. I think you need to tell them emphatically no.
Point I want to make, man, is about the Second Amendment. And you hear a lot of people make very specious arguments, whether online or on TV or on the radio. If you ever hear someone say, I believe in the Second Amendment, but if they put that three-letter preposition button there, just totally disregard their statement because they do not believe in the Second Amendment. With that, I leave you. I bid you adieu. Until the next time, you guys be safe out there.
Go Warriors.